In this video, I'm going to talk about how I implemented the abstract factory design pattern for no good reason. I will cover some of the key elements of this system, as well as a few related aspects. The full source code is linked in the description, including my amusingly oversimplified 3D buildings and vehicles. Everything started when I went on a walk with my design pattern Bible from 1994, which I keep close at all times, as every good enterprise developer does. After my recent projects, I was at the point where I was playing around with 3D objects, terrains and shaders, and I thought that it might be fun to mesh everything together. I started with some vehicles to move around and a small production building. Immediately my enterprise survival training kicked in and I felt that it was my duty to integrate the abstract factory pattern. The abstract factory is one of the most infamous patterns, especially in the Java world, and allows you to, quote, provide an interface for creating families of related or dependent objects without specifying their concrete classes. I will try to break down and examine the description as good as I can. Please note that because I tried to be clever, I used the abstract factory pattern in a virtual vehicle factory scenario. However, as it turns out, this might make things slightly harder to follow, as it means that the word factory applies to both my magnificent building model as well as the design pattern itself. Or maybe it will help some people understand. Who really knows? Anyway, let's start drawing up the pattern. First off, we have the client class, which wants objects and does not care about specific implementations. In our case, the client needs vehicles, which can be of type cars or trucks, but the client does not care if they are slow or fast. The same goes for the factory class, which can have several implementations depending on the available object families. Only once a specific factory implementation is selected, it becomes responsible of instantiating the corresponding objects, in our case, cars or trucks. During all of this, the client only ever has to deal with the high-level interfaces and/or abstract classes, leading to benefits such as encapsulating and delegating object creation and changing concrete implementations during runtime. As mentioned before, the abstract factory pattern allows you to encapsulate and delegate the object creation into the factory itself. In other words, the client does not need to instantiate any concrete objects and simply requests the factory to return something of the type vehicle. Please note that in the classical book example, not all objects need to implement the same base class, such as vehicle, which is why I put a dashed line around the vehicle interface. However, it made sense in my case, as my objects were almost identical and I did not want to repeat the movement code on both object families. In any case, having the factories deal with the object creation allows you to tailor everything exactly to your needs and allows you to more elegantly structure your code at the expense of adding extra classes and abstractions and making everything harder to understand for everybody else after you are done. Wikipedia points this out as well. Another advantage of the abstract factory pattern is the ability of changing concrete implementations during runtime. This is possible as the client only ever interacts with the abstract interfaces. This also means that an abstract factory can simply be replaced by another abstract factory and everything will continue to work. This is illustrated here by changing a truck factory to a car factory. As we can see, everything remains the same. Our painted building changed its vehicle factory type without any further impact. In case you wonder why the smoke particle effect is stopping and starting when we assign another abstract factory to the building, well, this is due to the fact that we have to briefly deactivate and reactivate the factory building game object when we remove the old truck factory and add the new car factory. My client implementation might be a bit tricky at first due to the aforementioned factory naming issue, as well as some other questionable design choices. However, I tried commenting it in case you want to have a look yourself. In any case, most importantly, you can see that we have a list of factory transforms, or buildings if you prefer, which all have an abstract factory attached to them. This happens through the assign factory to building method, which shows how we can change the abstract factory implementation during runtime. The abstract factory interface is quite boring. As explained earlier, we have a very generic interface which creates some types of objects but has no implementation. However, if we look at the two concrete implementations of this factory, we can see how the interface returns different objects depending on the concrete implementations matching the object family. In real life, The factories of course would differ a lot more than this, where we just change a bunch of constants, but I will come back on this at the end of this video. Lastly, we have the object families which all implement the vehicle interface. Although not a requirement, the vehicle interface allows us to store the shared movement code somewhere where it makes sense. If we look at the concrete implementations, we again see that they all look very similar, as this is just for demonstration. The smoke effect interruption from earlier is an excellent example on how I found it difficult to force the abstract factory design pattern into my project. First off, yes, of course, you should never try to force the integration of a design pattern, but I like to break the rules. Furthermore, the Unity concept of having prefabs does not go well together with this pattern from what I can see. If you look at the code, you can see that we need hard-coded references to the object prefab names in order to load them in the factories. This hard-coded binding then somewhat defeats the purpose of having a clean and separated object family, at least in my opinion. Maybe there's a better way to do this, but I'm already editing this video, so now it's too late. When design patterns were first introduced to me during my studies, I was convinced that they would change my programming world. However, in reality, I think I've rarely seen design patterns which were implemented as illustrated in the textbook. Of course, the singleton pattern is everywhere and everything is a builder nowadays, but some of the more intriguing patterns are rarely implemented, at least in the code I get to see. Far more important seems to be the ability to understand the different designs and to reuse whatever makes sense for your particular need. In this video, I implemented the abstract factory, which was more or less completely useless, as this could have been achieved a lot quicker without going through all the trouble. However, the family of objects hierarchy part of the pattern might still have made sense in case of future extensions. Generally speaking, people will also argue with you that you should favor composition over inheritance, which is not that easy when having object hierarchies. Again, I think that using whatever fits your needs and makes you happy is key. That's it for this video, and I thank you for watching.